Welcome to those of you who are joining us early. And as always, we love to have a little conversation starter. And last week, we talked about the sovereignty of God. And today, we're going to be talking about God and who God is as defined by the Apostles' Creed. The question I'd love to throw out there and have you answer for me so that I can kind of field those and answer some questions based on that during the sermon today is, how does God rule? How does God rule over all creation? And specifically, how does God rule over you and me as human beings? I'd love for you to comment on that as we continue to prepare our hearts for worship. So share the answers, get yourself a cup of coffee, and get ready. We're going to be worshiping here in just a few minutes. and welcome. Welcome to live worship. And that sounds weird to say. We have not had live worship with a band and a host and everybody on stage for several months. It's just another step back toward our total reopening. In case you haven't heard, tomorrow night, Monday night, will be our first live worship service at 6:30 p.m. If you haven't already done so and would like to come, we're limited in our seating. No childcare will be available. Limited seating inside, 162 seats. You can go online to our website and register for one of those seats. The link and registration is going to be open till 2 p.m. We also have big TVs out on the front porch for you to gather for those who can't get registered or would rather just be outside. Right now, it is great to be together. As I said, live worship. I got to admit, it feels a little strange because we're live, but there's nobody here in the auditorium. So what I need you to do is to participate in spirit and in truth so that we can worship together. If you do me a favor, before we begin to worship this morning, if you're in the comment section, let us know you're here and fill out one of our digital connect cards. I would certainly appreciate that. Share this link with all your friends on Facebook. And finally, we're going to be back in a few minutes and we're going to, I'm going to come back in a few minutes and we'll pray at the end. So please go ahead and start your prayer concerns. Begin to fill out a prayer card. We'll pray for those at the end of service. And the question I asked in the countdown was, how does God rule? When you think about God and who God is what we're going to be talking about today, how do you see God ruling over creation? More specifically, ruling over you and I today. Love the answer, and the answers that you give, I'm going to kind of craft some points in the message and look forward to that in a minute. Right now, I just invite you to breathe in and welcome God through the power and presence of the Holy Spirit as we begin to worship together.
You know, usually we start off service by saying, welcome home, and it kind of feels like the roles reverse. Thank you for welcoming us into your home. We know that this is still a little different, but we're excited to be able to be with you live in worship. We believe that our God has something amazing for us through the start of this new Believe series, and we just encourage you as we sing together in worship about God our Father. I come to you with nothing left to prove. You know all I need. I need you to help me. Covered in my shame. Shouting, oh my God, my Father, my hope. There's no other, you're everything, oh, everything, oh. Oh my God, my Father, my hope. There's no other, you're everything, oh, everything. Lord, I come to you, nothing left to sing this out together. You can have my heart. You can have my heart. You can have my soul. You can have my life. You can have it all. You can have my heart. You can have my soul. You can have my life. You can have it all. You can have my heart.
my Father, my hope. There's no other, you're everything. Oh, you're everything. You say, oh my God, my Father, my hope. There's no other, you're everything. Oh, you're everything. Oh, 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 oh. You can have it all.
As we continue in worship, we are excited to share with you a brand new song. It's called King of Kings, and we're kicking off a brand new series called Believe, and it's all about taking us section by section through the Apostles' Creed. And so we hope that you like this song, but more than that, we hope this song becomes like every Taylor Swift song ever, and that is you hear it one time, and then it's going to be stuck in your head forever. So even as you leave here later on today, throughout the week, this song will kind of just resonate in your mind, and you'll be able to remember the truths that we've been talking about through the Apostles' Creed as Pastor Mike brings us this brand new message series, Believe. But Liz is going to lead us in this, and I just want to say I'm so thankful that Elizabeth is back with us, that she's healthy enough to be here. She's still on the road to recovery, but she's good enough to sing, and we're so happy for that.
Shall not faint by his blood and in his name, in his free.
Praise forever to the King of Kings. Hey, if you didn't get in on answering the pre-service question about how does God rule over all creation, we just sang about several ways. Obviously, God is the King of glory, the King of all kings. So still time for you to answer that. Right now, I'd like to invite up to the stage Sherry Hunt. Sherry is in charge of programming at the New Hope Resource Center. As you know, we blessed and sent Pastor Jennifer down to Cape Girardeau, and Sherry is doing an incredible job there at the New Hope Resource Center, one of the ways that we do outreach in our own community. But we're also not just doing things here in our local community and feeding, you know, kids out of the Backpack Impact, but we're doing ministry around the world, internationally. And I heard recently, this past week, that our kids did something really cool through the virtual vacation Bible experience. Our kids have got in on international missions. So Sherry, welcome. Tell us a little bit about what the kids are doing.
Yeah, so if you have been with us to Honduras, you might know that it's very, very mountainous. And our partner church there, Pastor Marvin, actually pastors two different churches, and he goes back and forth between these two communities, Esquapa and La Hagua. And it's on the side of a mountain. It's a little scary to ride it in a van, but knowing that he has been doing it on a motorcycle, it's a really, really important thing for him to not have to walk that with his young family. And his motorcycle broke a while back. We have been trying to figure out for months how to raise the money for this motorcycle so that he can continue to effectively minister to both communities. And then finally, the kids did it. VVVX, they raised the money, and now we are able to support him. So they are being missionaries right where they are and supporting our international partners.
That's awesome. Hey, parents, great leadership that your kids are stacking hands with one another, stacking hands with us, and helping needs get met literally around the world. And we've got a pastor who's able to be more effective, to have more energy pouring into ministering to his own churches and also sharing the gospel with others in those communities in Honduras. So thank you. And parents, thank you for your generosity, all the ways that you have continued to support us right here at Morningstar Church all year long when we were here, and now that the doors of the building are closed, and yet you know, man, the needs in our community, the church is still open, and we are meeting needs through the New Hope Resource Center every single week. So thank you for all the ways that you support all the programming and activities here at Morningstar Church. Can't wait to be back here in worship together and see you very soon. Right now, I invite you to give your generosity a big shout out. Thanks to those of you who've gone online and automated your giving. We invite you to give generously as we continue to minister to the needs of one another and our community. If you're joining us from another church, hey, we invite you to give as well. You give to your church, support them, because when you get back, they are going to need to be as strong as ever. Thank you for your faithfulness. Let's take this time to give our tithes, our gifts, and our offerings as the band comes back to lead us.
God is not a man. God is not a white man. God is not a man sitting on a cloud. God cannot be bought. God will not be boxed in. God will not be owned by religion. 'Cause God is love. God is love. Loves everyone. God is love. God is love, and He loves everyone. God is not a man. God is not an old man. And God does not belong to a government. God is not a flag. not even American. And God does not depend on politicians. But God is good, God is good, and He loves everyone. And charlatans and communists and lesbians and even old Pat Robertson, oh God, He loves us all. Catholic or Protestant, terrorist or president, everybody, everybody love, 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 love. La, 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 la. La 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 la. God is love, God is love, and He loves everyone. God is love, God is love, and He loves everyone. God is love, God is love, and He loves everyone.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, who helps those who help themselves.
I believe the Father has a plan for all of us, that there is always a divine reason for all that happens. He will never give us more than we can handle, and that we should play the hand the good Lord deals us.
I believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who, above all else, was a really nice person, who desires that we are really nice people as well. He is ultimately most concerned that we are happy no matter what.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, that it is good, and that it can dwell in all of us.
I believe in the church, an earthly place to visit God on Sundays, and that some of our income should be given to support it if it's available. Attending church is good, but not required to be a Christian.
I believe that it is easier to ask for forgiveness than permission.
I believe that all good people go to heaven and that a loving God would never send anyone to hell.
I believe that all religions teach the same thing and point to the same eternal and divine destination. Amen.
Hello and welcome to Believe. Welcome to Believe, our new series, and what's interesting about this word is obvious in the way that we've laid it out here on our word mark. These three letters right in the middle of the word, L-I-E, lie. Now, obviously, when it comes to any religion, what we believe about God, what we believe about our faith is incredibly important. But like all religions, Christianity has lies that have crept in to what we believe about God and how He relates to us. Those lies sometimes escalate to the point of being full-blown false teachings or even heresies, which is why it's so important that we counteract those lies and teach the truth so that we know who God is and we're not living out of a lie that robs us of the blessings that God has already prepared for us. Now, Robin just sang that song, God is Not a White Man, and all kinds of other misperceptions about who God is and how God rules. Here's some other misperceptions that get right into, you know, the fabric of our DNA. You've heard these things said. Maybe you've even said some of these things, right? God won't give you more than you can handle. We've all heard somebody say that, right? There's a reason this is happening to you. And a follow-up to that, it's all part of God's plan. Well-meaning people say these things. Again, I know we mean well. God helps those who help themselves. That, you know, pull yourself up by your bootstraps. God is basically, you know, helping those who help themselves. You know, there's an element of truth, a little element of truth in each one of those. However, none of them are completely accurate. Search the Bible. You won't see these things in the Bible. Never will you see God won't give you more than you can handle. It says God won't allow you to be tempted beyond what you can get out of. And he always gives us a way out of that temptation. You see, as a culture, the truth is we don't know really what we believe. And so much of what we believe isn't even accurate. But we aren't the first to struggle with these lies. Consider all the way back in the first century, the Apostle Peter wrote these words. But there were also false prophets among the people, just as there will be false preachers and teachers among you. They will secretly introduce destructive heresies, even denying the sovereign Lord who bought them, bringing swift destruction on themselves. Consider that Peter was one of Jesus' disciples, right? And not one generation after Jesus had lived and been crucified and raised up from the dead, not one generation did it take before lies began creeping in to what was being taught about God. Now, over the years, as I said, some of those lies have gotten to the level of false teaching and even full-blown heresies. Some of these have included the idea God, the God of the Old Testament and the God of the New Testament were somehow different. Or another lie was that became a heresy was that Jesus was not fully God. And yet another heresy said that Jesus was not fully human. Another heresy denied the existence of God as three in one, what we know as the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit that we sang about in that song that Elizabeth led, right? And in response to these heresies, the Christian church began to come together and formulate what are called creeds. Now, this word creed comes from the Latin credo, which means I believe. In very short terms, a creed is this is what we believe to be true. This is what I hold to and what I profess to be true about God. Now, the New Testament actually has some creeds, some very early creeds of the church inside them. Paul writes this in 1 Corinthians, "For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance." And then kind of a creed that many Christians would have had memorized back in those days. Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. He was buried. He was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. And that he appeared to Cephas and then to the 12. Here's what he writes in 2 Corinthians. He says, "For what we preach is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord." Jesus Christ as Lord. Christ is Lord. That was the earliest of all creeds. It was in response to the creed of the Roman Empire that said, Caesar is Lord. And so the Christians would say, hey, there is no one higher. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is Lord. Lord. Now, over time, as you might imagine, as we got further and further away from the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, more and more lies begin to creep into the early church, which is why it was important for these creeds to be formulated. And over time, the creeds became a little more robust, okay? Creeds did several things. Creeds defined what we believed. It kind of summarized the Christian faith. Back at the beginning of the year, remember we did a series called Long Story Short, where we took the whole Bible, Genesis to Revelation, and we condensed it down to 13 themes. Well, that's what a creed does. It kind of summarizes all of Scripture, and it interprets Scripture and theology correctly. And furthermore, one more thing, it unites us. It unites believers together. Oftentimes when we gather, we will say a creed. And it not only unites us with one another who are there physically present or, virtually present, but it also unites us to the apostolic tradition, believers throughout the centuries. Consider the Apostles' Creed, which is what we're going to be using as the foundation for this series. Interestingly, about the Apostles' Creed, the name Apostles' Creed wasn't actually written by any of Jesus' original apostles. Written actually years later by theologians and scholars based on the Apostles' teaching, which is where we get the term Apostles' Creed, based on the Apostles' teaching. Besides, it would probably be better to say, hey, this is the Apostles' Creed rather than the Creed according to Dave. Holds a little more weight when you say it's the Apostles' Creed, right? It was actually developed to counteract the lies, the heresies of that day. So let's just kind of walk through the Apostles' Creed together. And I grew up in church where we said the Apostles' Creed oftentimes every week in worship. And we begin, I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and was buried. He descended into the dead. The third day he rose again and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church. We're going to get to that. The communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now, obviously, if you were paying attention, which I know you were, the Apostles' Creed, like so many of the Christian creeds, focus primarily on Jesus, right? Was Jesus a man? Was Jesus, you know, God, or both and? And what about the Trinity? And so, you know, in the Apostles' Creed, again, so much of what we read was Jesus. In fact, more time is spent, more words given to Jesus than everything else that the creed mentions put together. But that doesn't mean that the rest of what the creed says is unimportant. It was short, it was concise, it was clear, but it's also incredibly important. And today, we're going to be taking a look at that first affirmation, I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Now, we're basically told three things: that God is a Father who is unlimited in his power, in his ability. And that's demonstrated most epically in and through creation. He is the creator of heaven and earth. The question for us is, what does that mean? What does that mean for us? Why is this so important that we know that God is an almighty Father, creator of heaven and earth? Well, A.W. Tozer says it a whole lot better than I would, so I'll just tell you what he says. How we think about God determines how we will act toward him. Think about this. What I think about God, who he is, how we behave, that's gonna influence how I act toward him, what we expect of him, how we live every part of our lives. Therefore, if we think wrong things about God, we've made a wrong image of God, an idol, because we have begun to believe in something that he is not. What we believe about God impacts every area of our life. Now, I want to rewind about 30 years. Some of you weren't even alive back then. I was very much alive, about 22 years old, when Bette Midler in 1990 sang a song that eventually would win her a Grammy, From a Distance. And here to sing is Mike Shrunk. No, I'm not going to sing, but let me just read these words, all right? And you'll thank me if you've ever sang near me. From a distance, there is harmony, and it echoes through the land. It's the voice of hope, the voice of peace, the voice of every man. From a distance, we all have enough, and no one is in need. There are no guns, no bombs, and no disease, no hungry mouths to feed. From a distance, we are all instruments marching in a common band, playing songs of hope, playing songs of peace. They're the songs of every man. God is watching us. God is watching us. God is watching us from a distance. Great song, great tune. Obviously had a lot of mass appeal. But what about the theology? Is it really accurate to say that God is watching us from a distance? From a distance? Well, according to research done by the Barna Research Group, 87% of Americans believe that the universe was created by God. This fact hasn't changed for decades. Nearly 90% of us have always believed about God. Furthermore, the research indicated that 72% of us in America believes that God continues to rule over his creation, that God is all-powerful, that God is the creator of the world who continues to rule over creation today. But the question is this: how? How does God rule? And that was the question that we asked at the beginning of service, and several of you have replied. One of you says, well, he gives us free will, but ultimately we have to submit to his law and open our hearts to others. That's a good response. I like that. It's good. It's accurate. He holds sovereignty over everyone and rules by consoling, loving, correcting, and guiding. Hey, some of you are on your way to ministry. Those are some pretty good responses. And listen, this is so important, what we think about God, because it affects every area of our life. It affects our prayer life. It affects what we think about miracles. Do miracles still happen for us? Gump said they do. I know, reference that, you know, again, shows my age. And then what about God's, you know, plan and purpose for our life? What we think about God has an influence on every aspect of our life and our relationship with him. Now today, I want to share three of the most prevalent theories out there about how God rules over his creation. And the first is called deism. And the image is kind of like a divine watchmaker. The idea of deism is that God created the world and then he kind of stepped away. Kind of like a watchmaker, you know, kind of creates this watch, kind of winds it up, sets it down, and steps away. That God watches over us, maybe. Maybe God watches over us. Maybe he just kind of walked away and he's on to something else. But if he watches over us, he certainly does that kind of hands off. He does that from a distance. In other words, he's not involved in stuff that goes on here on earth. And if I'm honest, there's a little part of me that actually likes this, because there's so much of what goes on in the world that we blame on God. So much of this pandemic, so much of, you know, our economy, so much of, you know, well, it happened for a reason. God's got plans for all. Well, God has plans. Okay, many are the plans of a person's heart, but God's plans endure forever. It's the purposes of God that prevail. Hey, listen. So much gets pinned on God that is really about poor decisions that we make. But God does not watch over us from a distance, uninvolved, aloof, out of touch. That's just not who we meet in Scripture when it comes to God. There's a second theory about how God rules, and it's called fatalism. Now, fatalism can go to one of two kind of extremes, either this computer program or chess game. And let me explain. Some of us have been taught and believe that God has predetermined everything that we have ever done, are doing, and will do. In other words, when we were born, before we were born, God kind of put together a little computer program that said Mike Schreiner. And in 1967, on September 18th, God kind of plugged the Mike Schreiner program into the universal mainframe. And everything that Mike Schreiner has done, even the very words that I'm speaking right now, have already been mapped out and predetermined by God. I'm just living out what God has already prepared for me to do. And he knows everything that I'm going to do because he put it together. The other extreme is that, you know, in terms of a chess piece, is that he hasn't predetermined it. He didn't kind of sit down and write out the program and plug it in, and now it's just playing out. That God is, he's involved, but he's moving me around. So that right now, you know, me taking a step this direction, God is actually the one who's directing me to take that step. That arm, God's doing that right now. I can't control it. God's doing this to me. And the ramifications are obvious, right, when it comes to personal accountability. I mean, if God has already predetermined, or God's the one responsible for everything that I'm doing, then that kind of lets me off the hook. I can do anything that I can do. I can be good. I can be bad. It doesn't matter. It has no ramifications because God's already determined that. It's already determined if, you know, I'm going to go to heaven or not. And what about faith in Jesus? Well, God's already determined if I'm going to have faith or not in Jesus. And what about prayer life? Do I really need to pray? What's the use of praying if God's already determined who gets healed and who doesn't, right? All kinds of implications on how we think about God. Now, there's a third view, and those of you who've commented, you guys were most in line with this one, the idea of theism. And when we think about theism, we talk about a father, or a more inclusive term, maybe a parent. I use father because that's how God, or Jesus referred to God. That's the God that we know in Scripture, Abba, our Father. And I love what Allison McGrath writes about this image of Father. He says, any idea of God being this impersonal being or force, this deistic God who's watching us maybe, but from a distance, any idea of that kind of impersonal being or force is discounted when we speak of God as Father. The Lord's Prayer is perhaps the most well-known example of God being addressed in this way, although the use of Abba by Jesus when he refers to Father is even more intimate. And you'll remember that Abba is the word, we would translate Abba as daddy. It's kind of like a little child looking up to their father and saying, Daddy, Daddy, help me. I'm helpless. Daddy, you're my father. I love you so much. I need your help. That is intimate. And that's how Jesus referred to God. And parents, fathers, mothers, we get this, right? God uses us to give birth, to conceive our kids, right? We, as parents, play a big role in guiding and developing our children, their behavior, their development. But hey, we are not ultimately responsible for every move they make, every decision they make, right? God is like that. Think about this. God is the ultimate source of our being. He knitted us together in our mother's womb. God knows our strengths and our weaknesses, and he cares for us like the perfect parent. The perfect parent. He loves us unconditionally. He exercises authority over us, but still gives us capacity to make our own decisions, which is what we talked about last week when we talked about God's sovereignty. God's sovereignty means that he's able to be in charge of all creation without having to control, having to micromanage our every move. He doesn't have to predetermine everything. He doesn't have to be like that puppeteer or, you know, where we're just a pawn on the chessboard. If you were with us at the beginning of the year, in February, we launched our Long Story Short series. And in the first of those messages, we talked about God being bigger than big, right? That God is transcendent. He's over all creation. But God is not just bigger than big. He's also closer than close. He's imminent. He's with us. He's come in the power and presence of Jesus and now in the power and presence of the Holy Spirit. God is bigger than big. He's transcendent. He's closer than close. He's imminent, and he's also good. He's gooder than good, right? That's who our God is, and it's what we mean when we say in the Apostles' Creed, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Now, if we believe this, if we really believe this, that God is Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, then it's going to impact our life, every way that we live and relate to God, especially our prayer life. And that's where I want to focus our challenge today, is how does what we believe to be true about God affect the way we relate to him in this intimate relationship called prayer? And so let me offer this threefold challenge, to know, first of all, that God is worthy of our praise. God's worthy of our praise. Now, oftentimes when we think about God and praise, we limit praise of God to singing and worship. And certainly when we sing our praises to God, he is glorified. But praising God shouldn't be limited to just the songs we sing in worship, but also very applicable to the way that we relate to him in prayer. Let me draw the analogy between our relationship to our Heavenly Father to our relationship with our earthly father or kids. Say, as a parent, I've got a 35-year-old and I've got an 18-year-old. Just graduated from high school last night. Talk about that one of these days on a video blog. But say my 35-year-old called up and said, "Hey, Dad, we're coming in from Nashville, and I'd love to just sit down. I'd really like to have just a little time one-on-one, me and you. And you know what I'm thinking? He's asking for something, right? He needs something. Probably, you know, it ain't money, because he's probably got a lot more of that than me, but he needs something from me. But when he gets here, he says, hey, Dad, you know, growing up, you did so many things for me. I just want to take a few minutes, and I just want to share the things that you did for me that blessed me so much. And he just begins to go back, you know, over the last 35 years, and the three or four things that I did right. Now, he begins to talk about the things that I did to bless him. Now, after I wake up from passing out and rub off the bump on the back of my head from hitting the ground, how do I feel that my son has driven in from Nashville and he wants to carve out time in our conversation just to praise me? I mean, I'm blown away. And when we think about praising God, is there a better way that we can demonstrate our love for God than to praise him, to thank him for all the ways that he's blessed us? All the blessings that we have, most importantly, our salvation, but everything that God has done that has come to bear in and through our life. I mean, the Bible tells us, Jesus tells us, you know, the most important thing, most important commandment, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. Is there any better way to love God than to begin praising him? And so our prayer life, if we believe that God is Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, then he's worthy of our praise. And it also follows that God is worth listening to. If he's our heavenly Father who's created heaven and earth, then he probably knows a few more things than I do, and it's probably the wisest thing I can do to just be silent before God and listen to him. Again, same kind of scenario. Say that my son invites me over to his house, and he says, you know, Dad, over the years, as you know, I've kind of always thought I've got this life thing figured out, and so many times you'd say something, I just roll my eyes, and I'm thinking, oh yeah. But then he says, you know what, the truth of the matter is, the older I get, the more I realize that I don't know it all, and you weren't perfect, Dad, but you did so many things right, and so I'd just like to take the next 30, 40 minutes, and I'm just going to be quiet, and I just want you to share some stuff about, you know, your marriage, how you and mom kind of always were able to kind of work through things and work things out. And, you know, in terms of finances, in terms of, you know, raising kids and the way you looked at other people. And I'm just going to be quiet. I'm going to take some notes and just listen to you. Again, as a parent, you're like, what? You kind of wake up from passing out and you feel so honored that your kids are just kind of sitting there listening to you, even though you weren't perfect. But think about our perfect God, right? Father, Father, Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. We need to not just bring our wants and needs to God, but we need to come to God with an open heart, kind of like Mary sitting at the feet of Jesus. Just, you know, God, tell me, let me just listen. And so when we read scripture, after we read scripture, it's why scripture is so important to our prayer life, that we read that scripture and then we just sit. And that's called meditation, right? We're meditating. We're allowing the words of God, who God is, his word to us, his love letter to us. We're allowing that to soak into our very being and meet us directly where we are. Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And then one more thing, if we believe that's who God is, then it will affect how we pray, because we will know that God is able to do the impossible. He's not just our Father, but he is the Father Almighty who demonstrates that epically in creation, that sings out all around us, that testifies to the power and presence of our God. Friends, this is the God who delivered the Israelites from bondage in Egypt, right? He's the God who came and walked among us in the power and presence of Jesus Christ, the one who walked on water, the one who broke the bread and multiplied the fish to feed 5,000, right? He's the one who healed the blind and the lame. Nothing is impossible for God, and that affects the way we are to pray. To pray boldly. Look at what Jesus himself calls us to do. He says, everything is possible for the one who believes. If you have faith, just believe and ask boldly. This is what Jesus tells us in Matthew. I tell you, even if you have faith as small as a teeny tiny mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. Now, when he says nothing will be impossible for you, that's not you apart from God. It is Christ in you, the hope of glory, the presence and power of Almighty God in you that makes our prayers possible, that to bring the impossible into being. And let me ask you, where do you need a breakthrough right now? Where do you need God to show up and do the impossible? Your Father Almighty to summon the powers that created the heavens and earth and bring them to bear in your life right now. Is it a marriage or a relationship that's on the brink of, you know, disaster? Has this pandemic cost you your job and your bank account is running on fumes? Maybe you or a loved one has just been diagnosed with a positive test. Maybe COVID, maybe cancer. Or perhaps you need a total makeover. For all intents and purposes, you've been living as if there is no God, or you've been living as if this God, you've bought into all kinds of lies about this God. The biggest lie about this God is that he's an angry parent who exacts revenge on us, and there's no way that he could ever forgive you for the mistakes that you've made in your life. The truth is that God wants to make you into a new creation, where the old is gone and the new has come, that you would be born again, that you would receive this new life that comes from putting our hope and trust in Jesus Christ. Hey, we're going to pray right now. And normally we just kind of end with a prayer of salvation. And we're going to pray that prayer first. We're going to pray this prayer of salvation. So if you've never put your trust and hope in Jesus Christ, I'm going to invite you to do that. And then we're going to pray according to this outline that I've shared about praising God, about listening to God, and then trusting God for all things to be possible. So let's go to God in prayer. God, thank you for the truth of your word, the creeds that help us correct any misperceptions about you, for the inspiration of the Holy Spirit that guides us even today. And Father, if there's a person in the sound of my voice who's believed lies about you, perhaps lies about themselves and how you relate to them, if you're that person listening today, I just invite you to take a step of faith, put your trust in a God who is your Father Almighty, who nothing is impossible for. Say, Father, forgive me of my sin. I put my hope and trust in Jesus Christ, his perfect life offered on the cross to pay for my sins. And now, God, fill me with the power and presence of your Holy Spirit so I might know that I belong to you forever and ever and ever, that I might know your plans and purposes for my life and follow hard after them all my days. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, if you've prayed that prayer, you can trust that God has sealed your salvation on this day and that he will begin at this very moment to make you into a new creation. Believe that the old has gone and that the new has come. Live into that. Let's continue in prayer. Father, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for your goodness demonstrated in creation. God, as we walk out into the world, we thank you for the sun and the moon. We thank you for the seasons that we enjoy here in Middle America. Even, God, the heat right now, we pray for those who are out there with no shelter and no place to go, that you would comfort them and guide them you would bless them, that you would use us to care for them. God, we thank you for your incredible love, that you don't love us like other people, that you love us unconditionally, that you don't hold grudges, that when we confess our sin, you don't even remember our sins, that you forgive our sins and you remember our sins no more, that you wash away those sins and you want to have perfect relationship with us. God, thank you that you don't want to do life without us. You don't want to do this day without us. You don't want to do eternity without us. Thank you that you love us so much that you have come in Jesus Christ to live our life so that you can identify with our hurts and our temptations, and that you have given us ultimately victory over everything that tempts us, victory over sin and death, that you have given us life abundant and life eternal. Father, we could sing your praises forever and ever and ever. You are a good God, a great God. You're the King of kings and the Lord of lords. And we praise and glorify your name. Now, God, before we lift up our prayer concerns to you, trusting in your power, we just pause. We pause for you to speak individually to us, wherever we are, in this moment of silence. Meet us, God. Speak to us. Teach us to be still and know that you are God. That's not just a scripture to memorize and say. It's a way for us to be, because you're speaking all the time. We're usually so busy, our minds so full, that rarely can we get so quiet that we hear your still, small voice echoing your love and guidance and direction. God, we bring our concerns to you because we know that you're our Father. We know that nothing is impossible for you. And so, God, we join with our church family and we pray for continued healing for our sister Liz. We thank you that she's here with us on stage singing, using the gifts that you've entrusted to her to bring honor and glory and praise to your name. And we pray for not just continued healing, but God, we pray for wholeness, for complete restoration. God, we join with Julie in praying for her dad's upcoming back surgery, that you would guide those doctors and nurses and help them do all that they can do through the gift of medical technology. And then, God, whatever can't be done by human hands, send your Holy Spirit to pick up right there and do what only you can do. God, we pray for Aaron. We stand with Aaron in praying for our kids who are going back to school and parents who are eager and yet anxious about, you know, these decisions about, you know, should they go or should they stay? And God, we pray protection for our kids and our teachers and our faculty and direction, divine direction and protection from you. We stand with Judy, who has a neighbor in the hospital with COVID, and for all of those, God, who are in the hospital, who are battling this disease. Some of us have had it and almost symptom-free, and then some of us, it just affects in ways that are just devastating what we have to live through, and some who've even died. And God, we also pray for those first responders, those people who are on the front lines giving care, your care, to those people and their families. And God, we pray for, we stand with Lisa in praying for the heart arrhythmia and for her and for Todd's job search. God, we know that Julie is asking prayers for her mom who's recovering and for continuous health for her. We pray your blessing upon her for that full recovery, that you would meet her right where she is right now and bring her health and wholeness. Daisy asked prayers for her mom who is recovering from the stroke. And God, we thank you for the progress. We thank you that Daisy's mom has been able to come home from the hospital. So we see signs of your goodness. We see signs of your healing. Now, God, don't stop. Just bring it to fruition. We stand with Bev and we pray for Noe, who was struck by lightning. And we're praying that this person continues to make it and make a full recovery there. And we stand also with Bob, who's praying for our neighbor Dave, who had a severe stroke. And God, stroke oftentimes means part of who we are has been repressed or perhaps even dies. And we pray not just for a restoration, but God, we pray for new creation, for you to bring into Dave's heart and life and to his family what only you can bring. God, we pray these things as Jesus taught us to pray, trusting that all things are possible for you. We pray this and we stand together. Wherever we are, we stand together as one today. Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, amen. Hey, thanks so much for joining us today. One final word, live worship tomorrow night, right here. We will not be broadcasting that over Facebook Live, but we do have seats available inside the auditorium as well as outside, 6:30 Monday night. Thank you for your presence and for all the prayers and ways that you continue to support us. Just invite you right now as we close, just hold out your arms and receive this blessing. Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, fill us with your unconditional love. Fill us with the amazing grace of your Son, our Lord Jesus the Christ. Fill us now with the power and presence of the Holy Spirit, that those of us who've gathered for worship might now go into the world and be your church, the hands and feet of Jesus in the world. And all the people at Morningstar stacked hands, agreed together, and said, amen. God bless you guys.